We're having issues here. Oh, go ahead. Good morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
Well, I want to tell you all about a phenomenon. I experienced it yesterday. I went to see a musical in Chicago, and I was saying to my friends that when they're trying, I was saying to some folks that when I worked in the Fine Arts Building at Ball State, one of the things that would happen is that I learned that while the house lights will dim for a second to tell the audience to get in place, at some point before the show, if you listen for it, some trumpet or something will play sort of a loud note as if they're warming up, and that's to tell all the other pit members, the orchestra pit members, to get into their seats. Funny thing, church does this too. I call them the three lulls. About 2 to 5 minutes before church starts, all of a sudden, all of you, whether you recognize it or not, will look at the clock at once and be like, oh, we've got time. Then, when church is supposed to start, you'll do it again. Without thinking about it, you all do this. I listen for it every Sunday. And then if church is running late and I'm 5 minutes behind, about 3 minutes in, 3 minutes past the hour, you all will get quiet all of a sudden and be like, why isn't church starting? And now that I've told you, it kind of ruins it, but trust me, once we forget about it again, it will happen every Sunday. And so anyway, that has nothing to do with anything. Today is the last Sunday of Easter 2024. The next Sunday is Pentecost Day. We are inviting, we have one child baptism, Brooklyn Antel, Callum McKitty, and Calder Schultz will be baptized as well. We have five students being confirmed, Everett Brown, Leah Burns, Callum McKitty, Thomas Mundell, and Calder Schultz. And we have four adults seeking membership, Pamela Mashinko, Susan Starr, Daniel Starr, Sue and Dan, and Becky Swerndon. So that's going to be quite an exciting day. We remind you that on Pentecost Day, we tend to wear red. You'll be admitted no matter what color you're wearing, though, but we tend to wear red. So if you want to, fit in that day, wear red. The altar flowers today are given in honor of Mother's Day, but also in memory of Linda Mills by Pat Hodgson. I believe that this week was Linda's birthday. And in memory of Madeline Lorenz, given by the Lorenz family. We have quite a few things coming up this week. We have the endowment meeting on the 13th, that's tomorrow. We have Staff Parish Relations Committee, that's on Tuesday, the 14th. And we have finance on the 15th. Now you may be saying to yourself, Pastor Michael, that's a lot of meetings. Yes, it is. Yes, it is. I also want to remind the United Women in Faith that May 18th, we'll be meeting at 8:30. Sarah, where will you be meeting? Here at the church? Fellowship Hall potentially going outside. So with that in mind, are there any other announcements today? Well, with that, why don't we begin our morning? Because today is not only the last Sunday of Easter Ascension Day, but it's also Mother's Day. And so if you are a mother among us, please raise your hand or stand now that we might honor you. That good them all. There they are. Well, I have chosen a special prayer written by Reverend Ben Gosden. It's a little bit longer than most of the Mother's Day prayers I usually do, but moms deserve it, so that's what we're going to do. Let us pray for the mothers and the mother-like among us. God of life and love, we give you thanks for this new day. We give you thanks for the rain and the restorative power it has to cleanse and nourish your creation. We're grateful, O God, for all the ways your presence is made known to us in great and small ways. whereby we are reminded of your steadfast love for us and for all people. On this day of celebrating your love, we give you thanks for those who have given us life. Let us not forget how often mothers embody your steadfast and relentless love. We praise you, O God, for your gift of motherly love, both gentle and fierce, both strong and humble, both kind and true. For mothers who have joined you in heaven and whom we miss dearly this day, we give you thanks. For mothers who work day and night to raise and care for their children, we give you thanks. We also remember those mothers who labor at this task alone. May we, your church, remember to uphold all families through our life together. For mothers who have lost a child to death and must carry on, we ask your mercy. May we all sustain these mothers in their time of need and answer your call to reach out to them in compassion and love. For women who are new mothers and those who are expecting children but are not quite mothers yet, we praise you, O God, for the joy and anticipation of new life. Grant that we never forget our duty to uphold these growing families, that in our shared life together, we may hear the call to be your disciples in this world. For all the women who longed for but never had children of their own, we give you thanks. These women have been living examples of your love and grace as they have answered the call to nurture and care for others. We also pray, O God, for the mothers who have failed to live up to the call of motherhood. We believe you are a God of healing, and we remember that we all stand in need of your grace. Where we cannot forgive, Lord, give us strength. We stand in solidarity today, O God, with mothers around the world who have watched their children die of hunger. Every mother who has been a victim of abuse, every woman who stands against a world that endangers her children in the name of war. We lift up to you the spirits of all mothers around the world, even those mothers we will never know personally. We praise your name and lift all mothers as we join together in this prayer. To God the Father, through the power of the Holy Spirit, in the name of Jesus Christ, amen. With this, let us prepare for worship by listening to the prelude.
Thank you. Those are some fast fingers. Will you please rise as you're able for our call to worship? You have heard what was written about Jesus in Scripture. He would suffer and die and then rise from the dead on the third day. You have heard how the same power that raised Jesus from the dead raised him to heaven and seated him at the right hand of God.
Jesus now lives to intercede on our behalf.
So let us come before God with confidence.
Let us praise our risen Lord, Jesus Christ.
Please remain standing for hymn number 707, the Hymn of Promise.
You may be seated. Let us be in prayer together. Gracious and mighty God, how thankful we are to be among you today, among these people that you have called by your own name, at this special time when we recognize and we remember your ascension into heaven, and how you, O Lord Jesus Christ, sit at the right hand of God the Father and intercede on our behalf. You tell God about the sins we've committed. You ask that we should be forgiven. You tell God about the struggles that we face. And in turn, he restores to us strength and healing. From the perspective of one who has walked among us, you explain to the heart of God the struggles of humanity. And God becomes that much more compassionate. And so, for our Lord Jesus Christ, who ascended so many years ago into heaven, and for his illustrious return, we look forward with hope and with joy. Bring an end to our warring. Bring an end to our disease and illness. Bring an end to our cruelty to one another. Bring an end to our injustice and oppression. O Lord, we look for the day when we see you again face to face, that we may all be restored, transformed, and healed. And so in praise of the Christ who cares for the widow and the orphan, Jesus who watches over the outcast and the forgotten, Jesus who cares deeply for the children and the downtrodden and for those whose martyrdom is the slow death of loneliness. Gracious Lord Jesus, be present in each of their lives, each of their moments, each of their struggles, even as we pray the prayer Christ taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Hear now this reading from the Acts of the Apostles. In my former book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and to teach until the day he was taken to heaven, after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself to them and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command: "Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." Then they gathered around him and asked, "Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom of Israel?" He said to them, "It is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes to you, and you will be witnessed in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." After he said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight. They were looking intently up into the sky as he was going, when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside them. "Men of Galilee," they said, "why do you stand here looking into the sky? This same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven."
We invite the children to come forward. Good morning.
Morning.
How y'all doing?
Good.
Doing good? I'm a little tired too. I actually came in 10 minutes late this morning. So yeah, the over there, Betty and Sue and Jillian can tell you, I got here 10 minutes late this morning, didn't I? But I wish I had some like superpowers, you know? The other day I went to vote and I was wearing my Marvel t-shirt. It's got M and then underneath it is like Iron Man and it has all five of the creatures. And as I walked in, this lady behind the table looked at me and she shook her head at me. I was like, "What?" She goes, "I prefer DC." Oh, but if you could, have you ever thought about it? Like, if you could have some sort of superpower, what you would want? Okay, tell me, what would you want, Calder? I'll get all of you. Go ahead.
I would go with element bending because it would help me build Legos faster.
Element bending, so he could build Legos faster. Everett?
I feel like teleportation would be fun.
Okay.
It would either be shape-shifting into animals or talking to animals.
shape-shifting into animals or talking to animals. Why not be greedy? Take them both. You know, you can have both. What about you? Teleportation? I wish I had the power to absorb all the other powers. You know, you could still keep yours, but I could have yours too. So I'd just maybe put a hand on your shoulder and take it and have that power too. So I would be able to talk to animals and teleport, you know. What about flying? Do you think you'd like to fly?
Yeah.
No, not so much yes?
Maybe.
Maybe?
Half and half.
Half and half? Why wouldn't you want to be able to fly?
An airplane.
Pardon?
An airplane could ruin it.
An airplane could ruin it? What about you?
A drone?
Okay.
Flying through storm.
Well, I used to think some of my favorite dreams when I was sleeping at night used to be when I could fly. And when I was a kid, you know, where it felt possible. But as I got older, now I can't seem to fly in my dreams. Every time I try, it's like, no, you can't do that. Well, today we're talking about a story in Jesus' life at the very end of Jesus' ministry here on earth. And it says that he was taken up into heaven, that he flew up, that he sort of lifted up into heaven. And there's actually a hillside in Israel where they built this church on it, and there's sort of this footprint in the sand, and they say that that is where Jesus actually ascended into heaven from. Probably not. But who knows? But can you just imagine what it would be like if all of a sudden you saw someone lifted up into heaven? Like, how do you think you'd react? Yeah, are you okay? I'd be looking for wires. I'd be like, up here, you know, getting a ladder and sort of going up above them. What's going on here? I don't know. But for the disciples and things, they were so amazed by it. God had to send two angels down to them and say, hey, guys, remember what he told you? Go do that now. But they were just kind of looking up. They say that turkeys and chickens are often so amazed at water, at rainfall, that they will look up and drown themselves because they're just so amazed that water is falling from the sky. They actually have to be trained how to deal with that phenomenon. Isn't that interesting? It doesn't help us get to the sermon anymore, but it's there. The reality is that Jesus couldn't accomplish all that he needed to do if he were stuck in one person in one place at one time. So after about 50 days, after Jesus was risen and came off the cross and was put in the tomb and came back to life, about 50 days afterwards, Jesus went up into heaven. And from there, we believe that Jesus sits at the right hand of God, and there he intercedes for us. That Jesus is constantly up there telling God how much he loves us and how much what we're going through in a way that only Jesus can, with an understanding that only Jesus could give. Jesus also said, it's good that I'm leaving now because soon the Comforter will come. And so when he's talking about this, he's talking about the giving of his Holy Spirit, who will give us comfort in Jesus' absence, who will give us gifts to deal with the struggles of the world. Next Sunday, in fact, we will celebrate the fact that the Comforter has come on the day of Pentecost, and we'll celebrate how God poured out his Holy Spirit. But in all this, Jesus makes one statement that I think stands out, at least this year, above all others. Jesus says, I will not leave you orphaned. You're not going to be alone. I will send my Comforter to you, your helper. And the fancy seminary word is paraclete, useless information, but there it is. And the idea that Jesus didn't want us to go through life without his Spirit and his comfort to be with us. So when you're having a difficult time in your life, and you will, it's just a matter of time, always remember to turn to God and say, God, send your Comforter to me now. Send your Spirit to me now so that I can face what I'm facing. So with that, I'm going to send you on back to your families, and I believe our wonderful Miss Connie King, queen that she is coming to give us our missions moment.
And she's roped me into this. Oh, okay. I got it. First of all, I know it's not 4th of July or anything, but I have a baseball tournament to go to straight after this. So I didn't get my holidays mixed up. But I'd like to start this morning by thanking everyone for several ways that you have shown love to others in the last month or so. First, thank you to all who came to our pancake breakfast. We were able to purchase 2 goats through Heifer International, and these goats will be such a blessing to 2 families and make such a difference in their lives. Thanks to everybody who purchased Nelson's tickets. As of Wednesday, we had to sell 600 tickets. We hadn't even sold 1/3 of those yet. So we called the company, asked them if we could please move it down to 500, and they said yes, but it's going to cost you a little bit more. But we totally sold out all 500 chickens on Saturday. So thank you to everybody that purchased, Carrie for working it. And so that was a giant relief and such a blessing that you all poured your love out and the community did too. So I hope you enjoyed your meal and enjoyed the fact that you supported Family Promise's mission of helping homeless families. Finally, thank you to everybody who came to our Cinco de Mayo luncheon, and we will have a report next week of the amount of the donation that we're going to be sending to the American Cancer Society for that. So we've eaten our way through the last month. Talk about superpowers. I would like the superpower of being able to resist desserts. That would help. Moving forward, we all know Connie won, number one in our church, and it's not this Connie. It's that Connie. You know, she does so much for so many people that it's unbelievable. And not just people, but lands, you know, all the work outside the church and everything. So she does deserve a big hand. Well, I heard her talking, and she said she needed something, so I thought, she helps everybody out, so we should probably help her too. But what I heard her say was, she needed underwear big time. So I mentioned to Pastor Deb, and she went and got Connie some. Do you want to... So, Connie, there's your big-time underwear. And I thought maybe the rest of our Portage family would buy you some, too. Would that be okay?
They don't have to be as big.
We just need another month of eating, and maybe. Okay, so that's not quite what she needs. She needs underwear for Operation Christmas Child, big time. Like 500 pair, sizes 2 to 14, because we, under the guidance of her, pack 500 boxes. So we have reinitiated the Undy 500. Now, we have 3 weeks to accomplish this. I know we can do it. Bring your undies, well, not your undies, but undies in through Sunday, June 2nd. There will be boxes in the back of the fellowship hall for you to leave them. Once again, thank you for always loving on our community and the world. And now, this is going to be our finish line. Happy racing to the kids' underwear aisle.
Please rise as you are able for the prayer for illumination. I know, that's literally what I was thinking. Saved us from the fall. Sing the joy of our redemption. Christ is Savior of us all. Alleluia, alleluia. Hear the resurrection call. From the Gospel of St. Luke, the physician, beginning in chapter 24. Jesus said to them, "This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms." Then he opened their minds so they could understand the scriptures. He told them, "This is what is written. The Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. I am going to send you what my Father has promised, but stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high." When he had led them out of the vicinity of Bethany, he reached up his hands and blessed them, and while he was blessing them, he left them and was taken up into heaven. Then they worshiped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy, and they stayed continually at the temple, praising God. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thank you. You may be seated. Well, I promise I'm not calling anyone out. Someone's cell phone over here went off and said something like, "It'll call you back." It was doing something automatic. I don't know whose it was. Doesn't matter. And then she said quite hilariously, "God will call back later," right? One day I walked into the sanctuary, and it was before we had these newer projectors. It was the old ones. And someone had forgotten to turn it off after church. And so I walk into the sanctuary, and right there in the center of the crossbeam, it said, "No signal." I was like, "Well, that's not a good sign, is it?" Oh, how funny these things are in our lives. You know, it's funny. It being Mother's Day, of course, I'm thinking a bit about my own mama. And you know, she passed a couple years ago. And being a pastor, I kind of thought I had the whole grief thing dialed in, you know, because you're like, oh, I help so many people when they're in their moment of grief. You know, I learned about the stages of grief in seminary, and you know, guilt and bargaining and all these things and anger and all that stuff. And you think about those things and you're like, okay, well, I've got the inside track, right? I'm now too smart to fall for those things, right? I'm just going to do this. And it was a couple months after Mom had passed. I remember I was just feeling awful. I was sad. I was laying on the couch downstairs in the den. I was laying there, and the house was completely quiet. Like, I didn't even have the television on. I was just literally laying in a pool of my own misery. And I was thinking, you know, God, what would it take? What do I need to give you or do for you that I could just have a couple more years or even an afternoon? Like, what can I do here, God? And all of a sudden, my brain goes, "Michael, that's bargaining." And all of a sudden, it was like, gosh, I'm not so smart after all, you know? I can't get around grief or sadness any more than anyone else. I guess I'm just going to have to rely on God's help, because at the end of the day, life can be difficult, right? Life can be hard. We have a moment here in Scripture where something important is happening. Something important, but it's not necessarily one of our major stories. Like, it is the culmination of Easter. It is that story. It is the end of the what we call the golden 50 days, where we celebrate Easter for around 50 days. It is this last Sunday before that happens. And it's the Sunday where we talk about Jesus arising into heaven. And if you ask people, well, what's your favorite Jesus story? They probably don't pick this one, do they? It's important, it's well known, but it's not necessarily one that would people say, oh, I just keep going back to that passage and reading it over and over and over again. And I think that's because we don't fully appreciate its importance and how important it is. On Easter Day, some 40-something days ago, I preached a sermon about three gardens. Do you remember? Of course you do. You probably called all your neighbors and told them, oh, there you go. Anyway, I talked about the first garden being the Garden of Eden, right, where everything falls apart. We talked about the garden tomb, right? And then we talked about, in the book of Revelation, this third garden that has the river, it has the river of life, it has the tree of life, and it has a marvelous city at its center. The New Jerusalem that came down from heaven like God, from God. And one of the things that we talk about in terms of that particular moment is that God has continually saved us through his actions. And God originally placed us in a garden. And the idea that it is a garden and a city is where we will end up. But that's where the culmination of all human history comes. And it's very important for us to realize that when we talk about the culmination of history and everything, we're talking about a sense of timelessness. You see, one of the things that we talk about, especially even in confirmation, is we talk about this concept of eternity. And I've talked to you about it before, that there are several views of eternity, one of which is Augustine's view of eternity. Augustine felt as though eternity could be understood as sort of an endless duration. And I use this image to help people understand what Augustine was talking about. And it does break down, like all metaphors, it breaks down eventually. But if you could just use it to help, sort of as a mental exercise, it'll help you understand. Imagine, if you will, a stainless steel sphere, an orb of stainless steel. Or even lead, which is harder, lead or stainless steel, Stephen? Steel, so stainless steel, right? And every 10,000 years, a dove flies by that orb and barely touches it with the side of its wing. For Augustine, eternity is the time it would take for that ball to be worn away. Right? A different view is an early church father by the name of Boethius. And Boethius said, no, eternity is stepping outside of time. Like right now, we live in time. But when eternity comes, we will step out of time into the fullness of who God is. And it will be as though all times are at once. It will be the completion of time, the fullness of time. And we will live and move and have our being in the very ground of God. And he says we can see this idea preached to us in the book of Revelation, in that final garden. He says, because in that book of Revelation, it says that there shall be no more moon or stars or sun. And he says, now, if you'll go all the way back to that other garden in Genesis, it says that he points the moon and the stars and the sun to mark the times. And so he says he's trying to show us that we're going to step out of time and just be in eternity, all times at once with God, right? This allows for several interesting theological things, but I'm not going to deal with any of those today. Instead, I'm going to step back one step back from this third garden and say, living in time, though, is difficult. Living in time and living not knowing what's going to happen the next moment, living in time and struggling to get from one moment to another, and the things that life presents us, that can be very, very difficult, can't it? Doesn't it seem as though that living with the uncertainties of time, it gives us a lot of anxiety? There's a new movie coming out, a Disney Pixar movie called Inside Out 2. And Inside Out 1 was about this young girl and sort of the thoughts she has in her mind. And they have these little creatures that are sort of personified emotions, like this one's sadness and this one's happiness. And now that she's growing up, apparently, one of the creatures that's going to show up in her brain is anxiety. And I tell you the truth, we all know, right? You get to that certain point in your life and all of a sudden you're anxious about everything, right? It just suddenly comes into your life somehow. And that uncertainty of time as we move forward through it, as we move forward through time, well, it definitely makes things interesting, but it can also make things difficult. When we go into that hospital room and we're waiting for the doctor to come back and tell us what exactly is going on with this, or even the moments that you have to endure physical or emotional pain, the uncertainty of not knowing what's going to happen that day at work, will you get the big account or not? That uncertainty that comes of will I get the grade or not? That uncertainty comes with they're mad, but I can't tell why. All of those situations that life throws at us. And the idea, and part of what underlines this whole thing, is the idea that at one point in history, God stepped out of eternity and into time with us. And Jesus, having come down to earth, come to the earth, and experienced our workaday life, the one moment followed by the next moment, followed by the next moment, and then the concept that Jesus ascended into heaven and now sits at the right hand of God, is the concept of a God who's walked into time, experienced what time is like, and then steps into eternity and now explains, you see, God, this is why they're doing this. You see, Father, this is why they're acting this way. You see, Father, this is why she's angry. This is why they're scared. This is why they're sinning. This is why they're doing the wrong thing. This is what is happening with them. And so this idea that Jesus goes up into heaven means that Jesus steps into eternity and explains to the heart of God what we go through in time. The Bible calls Jesus an intercessor. What is an intercessor? It's a famous, fancy word. Some people use it in churches and lots of places. But what an intercessor's job is you got one party over here and one party over here, and your intercessor stands between and sort of helps these people get into contact with each other. What they're really saying is, the reason they're angry is, they need your help with, they need your help with, we need some of these, I don't care what your politics are, we need some of these in Congress, right? I don't care which side you're on, that we need somebody like that right there in the middle, right?
Amen.
And this is what God is doing for us. These human beings, God, here's what they've done. God is upset with you. You have done these things. You are harming yourself, and he hates to watch it. This idea of Jesus sitting at the right hand of God and intercessing for us, explaining to God what we go through, and in turn, explaining to us the heart of God. Jesus also reminds us that the reason that he is ascending is so that he can give us his Spirit. In the Old Testament, the Spirit of God would sort of work outside of humanity. Every so often, the Holy Spirit would alight on someone, they would start preaching and prophesying, and then the Holy Spirit would fly away. And next thing you know, they would be just back to their ordinary selves again. But we read all the way back in the book of Ezekiel how God wanted to pour out his Holy Spirit so that his Holy Spirit could make a home right here in our hearts. And so Jesus is saying, once I step back into eternity, guess what? The next part of the fullness of God will be there. And not just there, but will reside within you. The gift of God's very breath, the gift of God's very being will be given to you. And so even though the ascension story is not our favorite story, it's not the one we turn to when we need comfort, it's interesting to me that that doctrine, that truth, that story is the source of our comfort. It's because of Jesus' ascension that God understands us and understands what we go through and understands our suffering. And we look forward to the day when we too pass through the veil of time and into eternity. We look forward to the day when we too shall see God face to face as God now sees us through Jesus Christ. Today's we tell the story of the Ascension because it is vitally important that we know that if the throne room of heaven were a bunch of bleachers, Jesus would be the one on the bleachers embarrassing us like our mamas do. Come on, you can do it. You got this. Come on. Come on. Did that one just hit my son? I'm going out to the mound myself. That all of that imagery, if all of life were a baseball game, Jesus would be the one in the bleachers cheering for us and rooting for us and making sure everyone understood, that's my baby. You know, one more mama story to round it all out. It just so happens that in my life, I too suffered a broken heart. Yes, we've all had the breakup, haven't we? We've all had that experience of having someone break up with you. And my sister, you know, my sister had a divorce. And I will tell you one thing about Steamrollin' Sue. I really felt bad for the people that broke our hearts. I really felt bad when Mom got in her car that day and drove over to my brother-in-law's house. I really did. He had no idea what was coming. Talk about living in the uncertainty of time. Part of the reason that we believe so much in Jesus' intercession for us, part of the reason that we can connect the concept of Jesus in heaven to our mothers is because he is so fiercely loyal to us. No matter what we have done, no matter where we have been, Jesus still continues to proclaim the love of God in our lives. There's nothing you could do, at least among the good mothers of the world, that could make them stop loving you. Now, I want to pause for just a moment, and I do want to acknowledge something in the room. I know Mother's Day in church can be hard for a lot of people. It's not exactly easy for me with knowing that Mom has passed, but there are lots of people in this room and out there in the community whose mothers were not able to offer them mothering. There are a lot of mothers out there who have damaged or abused their children. And I want you to know, and I know that on a day like today when we talk about loving mothers and all that stuff, it's not easy for you. First thing I want to do is say thank you for coming. I know a lot of people who skip church on Mother's Day for just that reason. So first of all, thank you for being here, whoever you are. Second of all, I want you to know I see you and I hear your pain. And in all my prayers today on Mother's Day, I'm praying for the pains that you suffered in the home that you grew up in. And I want you to know you're not alone. So with these things in mind, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, we are thankful that Jesus is interceding for us, rooting for us, and for those among us who especially need it, Jesus is a loving mother to all of us. Amen. The time has come for the giving of our tithes and offerings. Jesus, our Lord, is teaching us that it is more blessed to give than to receive. Will the ushers please come forward?
Thank you.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise God, all creatures here below. Alleluia, alleluia. Praise God, the source of all our gifts. Praise Jesus Christ, whose power uplifts. Praise the Spirit, Holy Spirit. Gracious and mighty God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon this congregation and upon these gifts, that in the same way these gifts become a marvelous ministry in the world, may we too be ministers of your word, doing the work of God. Gracious one, wherever there is suffering or sorrow, let us be a balm of healing. Wherever there is pain, wherever there is loss, help us to be comforters. In all these things, God, help us to love one another as Christ loved us and as we continue to love you. And all God's people said, Amen. Well, before we go to our final hymn, just a quick note about next Sunday. Next Sunday, we have so many people joining the church that we're not getting out on time. Isn't that awesome? So just be prepared. You're not getting out on time because it's a big festival day, but there will be cake, so that makes up for it. Our next hymn this morning, Sing with All the Saints in Glory, number 702. That's not right. Oh, it is? Okay. Oh, the other hymn was 707.
Sing with all the saints in glory, sing the resurrection song. Death and sorrow, earth's dark story, to the former days belong. All around the clouds are breaking, soon the storms of time shall cease. In God's likeness we awaking, know the everlasting peace. Oh, what glory far exceeding all that eye has yet perceived. Holiest hearts for ages pleading, never the joy received. God has promised, Christ prepares it, there on high our welcome waits. Every humble spirit shares us, Christ has promised again. Life eternal, heaven rejoices, Jesus, who once was dead. Join we now with deathless voices, child of God, lift up your head. Patriarchs from the distant ages, saints all longing for their end. Psalms and poems, glory give.
And now may God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit go with thee. May you be blessed, going forth from this place to proclaim the joy of Christ in the world. Amen. And now, since we're about to partake in our Mother's Day feast, Let's pray for our meal. Gracious one, for the food that nourishes us, for the hands that prepared it, we ask your blessing. We pray that in the same way this food nourishes us, we may be nourishment for the world, that the hungry would be fed, the naked be clothed, those without shelter will be given it, and all those that are outcast will find a home. In Christ's most holy name, amen.
Mother's Day.